The other dignitaries on the panel is Ms. Abha Narayan Lamba, who again from Mumbai is a very well-known conservation architect. We have Srimati Jaya Jaitley, who besides being an eminent social worker and a politician, is also the person who has made the Delhi heart, something that has really, like, you know, put Indian craftsmen on a global stage. She is responsible for the establishment of the Delhi heart, the Dastakari Heart Samiti. And we have Mr. Pradeep Madhavji, who is the chairman of the SAARC Tourism Council and also serves as the head of the Indian Ocean Tourism Association. He has been into tourism industry for his life, and I think one of the best speakers to speak about this very important link of tourism, which actually enables all the cultural and religion and all the other artistic exchanges to flow across countries. And last but not the least, we have Mr. Narayan Parasuram, who is the creative director of Karari Tales, one of the finest publishing houses in India for children's storybooks. So I would now request Mr. Mahesh Bhatt to please take this forward. Thank you.
To position whatever we have to say, we start with the ladies and come to Mr. Parasuram ji. And then we will throw open the floor to the people to ask questions. Okay. They say that the history of nations is made by the story of its people. The year was 1984, and I had gone to Moscow Film Festival with a film of mine called Saransh, which got a lot of critical rave, a lot of appreciation, but was still financially in the red because it had not made enough bucks at the box office, because movies that talk about the finality of death, debunk reincarnation, and have an aging couple as central characters do not bring bums on seats, as they say. So I was there, and I was, after I got a standing ovation when the film was shown to a 2,000 plus audience, and we had a very eminent representation from India. We had Mr. Amitabh Bachchan and Mr. Gadgil, who was then the Minister of Information Broadcasting. I was high, intoxicated by the ovation, but a little despondent because we had still not made money, and as a director I felt obliged that my producer recovers the money at least. Just getting critical applause and was not enough for me. And that's when the miracle happened during breakfast in this huge hotel in Moscow. A Japanese gentleman walked up to me and, giving me his card, said that I'm very keen to make a purchase of the film that you showed, Saransh. And he was from the television network of Japan, the national television network. And I thought that miracles do not happen, but there was a miracle right in front of me. When he left, I asked a friend of mine who was accompanying me, he said, why would a Japanese representative from the television network be interested in the story of an aging Maharashtrian couple dealing with the finality of death and the theme of loss? And he said, Buddha. So I said, sorry? He says, Buddha. The 2,500 years ago, it was the Buddha who grappled with the issues of aging and the certainty of death and whether something endures after death. And that's when the key turned, and I discovered that even the great Akira Kurosawa, a man who made a classic like Ikaru, which dealt with a municipal clerk in Tokyo coming to terms with the finality of death because he's afflicted by cancer, finds the answer on a quiet night in the children's park, sitting on a swing. Similarly, Saransh, in a way, had found the answer to the problem of loss, finality of loss, and debunked the theory of reincarnation, and found solace in the interpersonal relationship in the small garden in Shivaji Park. And that's when I discovered that this is how we was stitched together by the great Buddha. The narrative of Buddha was something which had contributed to that purchase that was made in 1984 in Moscow. And then before I came here, I jogged my mind and I tried to scan through my memory bank and I discovered the great Tagore in 1916 had gone to Japan and had discovered that behind the apparent display of the industrial age, when he was on the railway station, he was very graciously felicitated by some Buddhist monks who came with incense and fruits and said, "We come to pay respects to a man who comes from the land of Buddha." And Tagore, who was perhaps despairing that he was would only have to deal with the noisy display of the industrial progress Japan had made, was touched by the silence of the monks. So I think what we share in common between Japan and India is, of course, the narrative of the Buddha. And I think that all art and all culture actually grows from the heart of the religious ideology of the nations. I think it's Buddhism essentially that keeps these two nations of ours, these two civilizations stitched together. And as we all know that Buddhism was born in India, it went to China, but finally flowered in Japan. And if you see the Zen Buddhist monasteries and you see their teachings, of course they're very subversive and they've moved away light years from what we knew about Buddhism, yeah. But nevertheless, we are still stitched together by that prince who walked away from his opulent palace and discovered the meaning and the mystery of the magic of life, and he still resonates 2,500 years later. And I think the effort of this afternoon would be that ultimately art culture is supposed to bring human beings together and bring a feeling of enduring peace. And I think this afternoon, we in our own way will explore those areas and find out how we as two civilizations can do something in this very difficult times to keep the monsters of violence away. Thank you. Over to the panel.
Deepi Hart over here. But something a little autobiographical which I'd like to share with you. And that is that in the earlier sessions in the morning, people mentioned shipyard, people mentioned India's friendship with Japan when nobody else was willing to befriend it. And somebody also mentioned an elephant which Nehru presented. Well, I'm the only relic left, the elephant has died. But I was the small child, 8 years old, the daughter of the first Indian ambassador to Japan, who actually handed that elephant over to the children of Japan at the UNO zoo. And I gave a little speech in Japanese on the radio, of which they made a record, a vinyl record, which is now crumbling, but still with me as a very fond memory. My mother launched the first Indian ship made at the Kobe shipyard, Jag Ganga, cracking a coconut instead of a champagne bottle on it, because we didn't believe in champagne. And one very other touching thing, which was my mother driving her as ambassador's wife on a very snowy night, and her finding a body, an impoverished, frozen Japanese poor person lying on the road, and she asked the driver to stop. She didn't have any money in her handbag, so she asked the driver to give everything he had and that she would return it at home, and got the person taken to hospital. Now this little story and my link and my already awakening senses to the beautiful art and craft of Japan is what has propelled me for the last 45 years to continue my love and engagement with Japan and to work both in social activism through craft to help those who are needy. So I have to really thank Japan for motivating me for so long, 45 years, and I'm certainly not going to stop in a hurry. So that's a little autobiographical stuff. I want to move to something philosophical now. And a guru of mine, along with Gandhiji and Kamladevi Chattopadhyay, was a Japanese potter called Soetsu Yanagi. And he has written a beautiful book called The Unknown Craftsman, in which he brings out the philosophy, actually, of Gandhi, where he says that the beauty of folk art, Minge, is in its anonymity. And the Indian craftsperson, from time immemorial, has done beautiful wall murals, wall hangings, lovely works of art, but which are craft and never signed his name. The idea was that if you put your signature, it's the individualism of the capitalist world. Whereas you worked as a community for a larger cause, sacred, and an offering to God, to whomever you believe in, a larger force that would then help you in your excellence of work. And also with that anonymity which we share with Japan and our craftspeople is the idea of how crafts have to be useful. One thing that has happened from colonial times to now is that Indian crafts, the small craftsmen on the road making baskets, making pots, any common cloth or chappal, or the carpenter who makes for the farmer, the basket weaver who makes again for the agricultural produce, these useful connections got lost. And the definition, according to just past colonialism India, for handicraft became something that is beautiful, could also be useful. Whereas the whole raison d'etre of craft was to give livelihoods in an environment-friendly way by taking the expertise of the hand and the mind and the soul and producing something which was for society. And you gained your livelihood from that. Now that concept still exists in India despite all the policies that we have followed to try and break it. So usefulness was a very important thing which we share. The oppression of the machine and fighting the machine. If you read Yanagi, you will see how much he repeats what Gandhi said. The machine is useful but must not enslave. The machine must not discourage and damage the human being from what he or she can normally do. And therefore this fight against mechanization, which Gandhi did with the charkha, which was a craft of spinning, was what Yanagi talked about, that what the beauty that emanated, for instance, from the pots made at a beautiful tea ceremony became a collection for him to establish the Folk Art Museum in Tokyo of ordinary folk arts and how beautiful they are. And therefore, why perfection is not necessary. The perfection became something where the artist became self-conscious. And when you become self-conscious, then you sign it. And when you're in a big mechanized world in mass production, you still have the owner of that mass production stamping their brand on it. Whereas our folk arts for common use was never branded. It was something that humanity did for itself and for each other. The environment, of course, I've mentioned. Protecting the environment by using grass, mud, earth, cotton, silk, natural materials. Which of the things that we use today are of natural material? If you look around you and look at your own homes, you will see how much actually which we take for granted today is actually going to destroy the environment tomorrow. And how the craftsperson, if we look back on that and share that old vision and culture of Japan and ours, how we can help with the environment by sustaining livelihoods, these sort of heritage skills, and the environment by going back to valuing crafts the way Yanagi and Gandhi did. The beautiful thing also, which brings in a little bit of sacredness, and Mahesh mentioned Buddha, is that in all our art forms where our artists paint any god, and in the 8th century, there was an Indian monk who was then in China, and at the Todaiji temple in Nara, they were placing the big image of Buddha, they invited this Indian monk from China to come to what they call opening the third eye, to do that part of the work. And they so honored this Indian monk that at the entrance of the hall, the king, the emperor came in through one door and the monk came in through the other. This was the link where the monk from India came to open the eye of the Buddha statue. And till today, the craftspeople whom I work with, when they make a Lakshmi or a Ganesh or anything, the beautiful artwork will only be completed with that last thing of painting in the eye. Because when you paint in the eye, then the God enters that painting, that body, that sculpture. What a beautiful thing that we share that most of us don't even notice these days. The commonalities in specifics in pottery, the tatami, the mat that they use in traditional Japanese homes, which are now getting lost. But in Kerala, in my home, and in Tamil Nadu, grass mats, what even in aristocratic households like mine, we slept on grass mats with an ordinary pillow and on a red oxide floor with a bamboo fan or a palm leaf fan. Simplicity of life, no matter what status you were in. This was something that we did share. Today, with the mechanized industrial world, everybody wants more and more gadgets that you don't need. But here is where, if you really want to talk about saving the planet, these are the things that we have to look for. The kasuri weaving. This is my sari, is ikat in India, kasuri in Japan. And the Japanese say that they got it from Indonesia, but probably they also say it actually came from India. So this style of weaving where you dye the thread, the yarn, in a preconceived pattern, and then you just, when you weave it, the pattern comes out. That in Odisha is ikat, and in Japan is kasuri. Indigo dyeing is very popular. Indigo dyeing was adopted in Japan on cotton for the poor because they weren't allowed to wear silk. Of course, we know the story of indigo and Gandhi in Champaran. And today, indigo dyeing is now being revived in many parts of India, and I believe could be an area of great cooperation for us both to provide the know-how and the spread of natural dyes in this world, which don't spoil water with chemical effluents and chemical dyes. Shibori, somebody mentioned in the morning, bandhani. Bandhani is shibori, tie and dye. So you decorate or embellish a cloth by tying designs with little thread. The many practices of shibori, the one that is now being taken up in India, is called nui in Japan, which is just stitching thread, not tying, and then dyeing it. So all these practices are in Japan and now being taken over in India, or shared long ago and need to be relinked again. Bamboo craft is another thing. With the whole of the Northeast, with so much bamboo, we still in India don't have an industrial recognition of bamboo for house making, for building. I think that right as architect you would know. So many beautiful bamboo homes, bamboo bridges are built all over the world, but in India we look down on bamboo, and I think Japan can perhaps help us with technology and recognition to take up something like bamboo. Finally, Kyoto and Varanasi. Last time I went to Varanasi, it was just after the Prime Minister was elected from there. And having loved Japan and being to Kyoto so many times and always visiting, I felt somehow when I entered Varanasi that time, I thought of Kyoto. Why? Because there is an old Kyoto still preserved. The Ghat part of the heritage of Varanasi, the cultural part of Varanasi. And then there is a huge new construction of colonies and buildings and shops and whatnots in the new Varanasi. But the transition between old Varanasi and new is something that we could learn from Kyoto. And this is, I believe it has been mentioned, I don't know how it's going to actually be done, but I think the urban landscape planners, the architects and others should think. I remember a Japan where there used to be rickshaws. Now there isn't, of course, but 30 or 40,000 rickshaws ply in Varanasi. And those are the poorest people, but 80% of the little lanes in Varanasi, you have to go by rickshaw. Why can they be not ergonomically developed? there are 1,500 beautiful painters, wooden toy painters, abject poverty in Varanasi. Can they not paint those rickshaws so that they become tourist attractions? So there are so many connections between tourism, art, culture, and developing old cities to transition into the new that we can do with Japan, which I think is as important. We're not a soft subject that we're on this afternoon. It's very, you know, with the economy and powering the economy. Kullad, a little story about the kullad. We use them, mud pots, to drink tea. Of course, now they're horrible plastic cups. Japanese visitors, when they came to Delhi, I gave them tea in these kullads. The next time I went to Japan, I saw that they had actually wiped those kullads, put it in their pocket, and taken them home and put them on their mantelpieces. There's so much lovely technology of pottery and ceramics, and our potters are on the roadside. Can we develop technology which they can share with us to bring our potters up to grade? Textiles, as I said, shibori, indigo, tie and dye. Can we link up so that the best of packaging and presentation, the best of technologies to, even when you use a machine, to use it sensibly and responsibly, these are all the areas that we can work and I think has a very big future. Thank you.
What struck me about Jayaji's talk is beauty in anonymity. And in this age and time when we insist on the name above the title, where we want our names to be planted on everything we do, I think there is something to ponder over, beauty in anonymity. And as I said, the artists did work for the community, and that itself was the end that they pursued. I once asked the Dalai Lama about, did the Buddha actually refused to enter the doors of Nirvana when it was open for him to walk into? And did he walk away saying that till even one man is in anguish or is in ignorance, he refuses to enter the doors? And the Dalai Lama took a pause and he said something which has stayed with me. I thought I should repeat it here. He said that only the one who wants enlightenment for everyone can be enlightened. And I think that is the essence of Buddhism, is when you want that light for everyone, not that light to be kept away in your treasure box or in your own personal vault to show off to the world that I know and you don't know, will there be some kind of an enduring peace? How about you?
Good afternoon. As a child, I think my first encounter with Japan was when I was in Calcutta, and I remember one of my early memories. I was probably 4 years old, and my mother would go to another house in Calcutta to learn ikebana, the beautiful Japanese form of flower arrangement. And her teacher was a lady called Mrs. Kazuko Nigam. And it was, for me as a child, just fascinating to see this Japanese lady who had just the most flawless skin and always a smile on her face, always dressed in saris, and she had just completely absorbed everything Indian because she married an Indian and came to Calcutta and lived there. And yet, in her very gentle way, she just touched so many lives by a simple thing like teaching how to arrange flowers. And over the years, it sort of led to a fascination of Japanese culture. And then I think I was sort of, the two times that I went to go to a very special city, special because it's in a sense a milestone of humankind, is Hiroshima. And in 2004, I went to Hiroshima first as a student of the United Nations Institute for Training and Research, because the United Nations established a wonderful institution that trains experts and students and scholars from across the world on various issues, whether it's site management of World Heritage Sites or other issues related to crafts and culture. And what struck me, I went back to Hiroshima a few years later as then a trainer for UNITAR, but what really struck me was walking into the Peace Memorial, so the actual site that was probably the worst human tragedy there is, of the atomic bomb being just thrown on helpless you know, people, on little children. And when you walk through the museum, which is a very large museum, and you walk through each and every artifact, and they have these amazing oral histories of from little children describing that moment, and the moment of, I mean, there were descriptions of children saying, how I remember, and children when they're much older. So an old man who was interviewed as part of the oral history record mentioned how he just saw his body flesh melting away, and that was one of the reactions to him being not even at the epicenter, but one of the outskirts, suburbs of Hiroshima. And you go through this, you know, amazing archive of human tragedy, one by one by one. But the most amazing part of that is when you're done with that 2-hour round of the museum, you come out and you realize that there is no sense of revenge, there is no hatred for a nation that had to go through such horrible tragedy. There was the interpretation of that museum is being done with such sensitivity that the first reaction would be, who did it? And, you know, and I want revenge, but that is not what you come out with. And I think that through that museum, the Japanese truly have demonstrated to the world that Buddhism may have begun in India, but it's been understood perhaps better than us in Japan, because with that sort of tragedy, and to completely forgive and to rise beyond that and to talk about using that site as a vehicle for peace was something that I don't think, it's something that requires superhuman courage. And yes, Jayaji mentioned Bodhisena, the Indian monk who went to Japan in 752 AD to consecrate the temple, the statue of Buddha at Nara. But then again, Nara gave back to the country and to the world, and especially to Asia, something that we, as a conservation architect, I would treasure. Because when we talk of conservation and historic buildings and monuments in the international context, this whole concept began pretty late. It began in the 20th century with something called an Athens Charter, where a lot of great architects and European leaders got together immediately after the Second World War, looked at the destruction that the world had witnessed, and said, you know, our great monuments and sites have been bombarded and have been destroyed, and we need to set an international protocol as to how we are going to save these, how we are going to restore them if they need to be restored, how these are to be preserved. That was then followed by the Venice Charter. So for the last half a century or more, the entire international dialogue on how to keep our monuments or our built heritage has been, in a sense, defined by the Athens Charter and the Venice Charter, which have a very strongly European bias, because they talk of preserving in a kind of a beautiful museum setting. They don't talk about the kind of Asian context of the pressures that we face in developing nations or in the Asian context. They talk about these, as Jayaji earlier mentioned, they talk about these grand pieces of architects' buildings that were designed where they can name an architect. So in Europe, you can say, oh, this is a Michelangelo building, and this is a Palladio building, and this is a Lutyens building. But in our Asian civilizations, we've never had this. We've never projected the man or the creator with his ego. How many people even know who, you know, the name of a craftsman who worked on the Khajuraho temple, or some of our most amazing on Ajanta caves or Bodh Gaya? The idea was that the creation is greater than the self, and that is something that is so Asian in its context, that for us as Asians to understand that sort of European idea of this great master creating this great product, and therefore you have to, you know, stay within the lines of the original drawings. Hell, we don't have original drawings for, you know, not even 5%, not even 1%, not even 0.1% of our monuments. They weren't, because we had a system of a Guru Shishya Parampara. So we had this system of a knowledge base that was transferred from human to human, from generation to generation. And then the NARA changed the dialogue of conservation, because the NARA document of authenticity is something that challenged the European and the international dialogues on conservation. And in the NARA document, they make a very simple fact. They say authenticity is also based not just on discussing whether this particular piece of stone was crafted by the same person or designed by the same architect. They say authenticity is also a matter of living traditions, of living crafts, and of living use. So if you have, and then another very important document, I mean another idea, concept that was floated by the NARA Charter, was that there is something called the spirit of place. So I never understood it as deeply as in 2004 when I was to work on the restoration of a 15th century Buddhist temple of the Maitreya Buddha in Ladakh. And that was up in a tiny remote village called Basgo, which had no electricity, no running water. The temperature was minus 20 degrees in the winter. So for 3 years, between 2004 and 2007, we would begin works at site in the month of May when the roads would open and close work in the month of October. And the monks did this most beautiful deconsecration ceremony, is that before we started the three-year project, there were these rows of monks who chanted, and they captured the spirit of the Buddha, wrapped it in muslin in a mirror and kept it safely. And then they said, now you can walk in with your shoes and your hammers and do what you want to the building. But when we were to decide how to restore this building, and this was being funded by the World Monuments Fund, so they said, we want international standards of conservation. And I looked at the Venice Charter and I looked at the Athens Charter and I said, it just doesn't fit. I don't have original drawings of the 15th century temple. I can't do the kind of interventions that is required from that point of view. And at that time, I looked to the NARA document and we did just that. We had not even a matriculate on the site. There was no structural engineer. There was no contractor. So the villagers, the Basgo Village Association, they contributed, they matched for every dollar spent by World Monuments Fund, they matched it with labor. So they gave their free labor. The mud temple was on the top of a hill, and they formed human chains of people to transport material from the bottom of the hill to the top. Each household gave two sticks of willow, which was used as part of the roof. So it was a kind of a contribution, but in kind and matching contribution. And at that time, we realized that if those memes or the old villagers, they understood the difference between a markhala clay and another clay, they understood the difference between a hay grass or a kind of grass to be used in the terrace and the bhojpatra that had to be transported from Kashmir to be used as a waterproofing material. And to me, that was living tradition. And we said, to hell with the Venice Charter and the Athens Charter, and we're going with the NARA document, because that explains the Asian identity and the Asian kind of conservation. And that, in a sense, is also so true of this whole idea of Buddhism of reincarnation. So you don't die and go to heaven or hell, but you take birth again. And that is why this whole concept of every year we have a Ganpati Visarjan and the next year we bring Ganpati back, and then it's a cyclic cycle of life and death, which is so Asian. And that is then what in a sense influenced my conservation practice for so many of these projects. And in each one of them, or at least in a lot of them, there has been some amazing connection which connected with Japan. In 2009, I was appointed by the Ministry of Culture to prepare the management plan for Ajanta Caves. And the entire management plan, as well as the larger program, was really funded by the Japanese International Cooperation Agency. Buddha sort of brought me back into another Buddhist site last year, and in between 2014 and 15, I got the opportunity to work on the management plan for Mahabodhi Temple in Bodh Gaya. And our entire team, just during the documentation and the surveys, we just camped in the Japanese temple at Bodh Gaya, and all we did was go to the bhikshu Aji and say, you know, our team is going to be here for nearly 2 months, and he says, tell me what you need. We won't give you amazing food. We won't give you, but we will give you, serve you tea in the morning and clean rooms and clean bathrooms. And we completely, for us, that Japanese complex was really home in Bodh Gaya. But eventually when we look at, so in a sense, the cycle came back personally as well, because when I got married, my sister-in-law, I would always hear the chanting, Namyoho Renge Kyo, and that is, you know, sort of, that is the strain of Buddhism that went to Japan and then sort of was further evolved and then came right back to India. So that is what your amazing temple at Prabhadevi sort of, in a sense, gives back to India, a more 21st century evolved practicing Buddhist strain. And I think that's so beautiful. But just to talk about the kind of collaborations that we can do. We see around us, and especially we see, Vizier coming into India, we've had the modernist architecture coming in, we have so much, you know, in terms of the art deco and the Gothic and the neo-Gothic. But one of our greatest designers, I would say, in India was Rabindranath Tagore. And when you go to Shantiniketan, you're really struck by the aesthetic of Shantiniketan and how it's such a divergence from what was being built in colonial Calcutta at the time. And that so much is derived from Japan and the kind of aesthetic that Gurudev brought into India, whether it was the tatami mats or the folding screens or the floor furniture that he designed in the buildings within Shantiniketan, is just like a tribute to the beauty of Japanese architecture. But when we see today in product design, in lighting, in architecture, in interiors, as we've all had sort of the fill of the Punjabi Baroque, for the lack of any other word, it is the classic lines and the simplicity of Japanese interiors, Japanese product design that we as a country really look up to. The same can be said for future collaborations, especially in the realm of disaster management, because with seismic retrofit and seismically designed buildings, Japan has really set the standards for how India can respond to buildings. We've had Latur and so many others. So just to wrap up, I would just say that it's come full circle. My daughter, who's 14, grew up watching Japanese television cartoons, Shin-chan and everything else. So I think soft power really has pervaded, our lifestyles. And I do hope there'd be future collaborations as well. Thank you.
Well, I've just been told speakers will have to stick to the time. I couldn't dare open my mouth in front of the ladies. When the ladies talk, we keep quiet. But I think after what, to sum up what Abha has just articulated so brilliantly, is that Buddhism was born in India, but actually flowered in that peace museum that you saw when you went as a little girl to Hiroshima. And I think that's what is the unique image that you have left with me, and I think that's what something we should ponder over. It was born here, whereby we take great pride in saying Buddhism was born here, but actually it is being lived there in Hiroshima and in Japan. And what you also said was we as a nation do not take this unique pride of putting our names onto every structure that we create. And this is something Ingmar Bergman, the great filmmaker, discovered in his winter of his life, what you have articulated so brilliantly in the spring of your life, is that if artists could only create without putting their names on the products that they make, maybe they would do society a great service and their art would also be really brilliant. So, sir, you are the next in line and we have to stick to the 10 minutes allocated. Thank you.
Mahesh Bhai, my colleagues on the dais, and my very good friends all around. In English, there are just two words I can spell correctly. One is obviously tourism, and the second is cricket. But today I will not speak about cricket. With she around, I think she knows cricket far more than any of us put together. You know why. The T20 is around the corner, so I will not speak of cricket. But just one thing, I thought, applying to Japan, my feeling was, sir, that the countries who drive on the left-hand side of the road, there's the British way of driving the cars, they play cricket, driving left and playing cricket. The only exception is Japan. They drive on the left side but don't play cricket. They spell cricket but they don't play cricket. I don't know why, someday I'll find out. I thought that mostly I will speak about the tourism, the changes which are taking place in my industry. It's the fastest growing industry. It's the fun industry, the sunrise industry. I can go on. It's a wonderful industry. But there are three basic things which generate out of tourism, and I thought I must list it out. One is very obvious, the foreign exchange earnings. Foreign exchange earnings would be if the flow of the visitor traffic, sorry, I'm spelling visitors, not tourists. In my dictionary, the word tourist doesn't appear. It's only visitors, because visitors could be for business, for medical, for studies, or whatever it would be. So foreign visitors. Flow of visitor traffic from developed to developing countries. I think that is what one is looking forward to between India and Japan, both. The figures which I have, the world, 7.8 million visitors went in India, came to India in the year 2014. That's the last published figures. But 7.8 million visitors, the foreign exchange earnings from them is in excess of $20 billion. $20 billion spent by 7.8 million visitors, which comes to a high of 2,600 per foreign visitor, which is world average is just 840. So they spend far more in India. Why? Of course, there's a reason for it. Maybe outside of this, I will be able to tell you. But this came to my mind. It was published by Vasundhara Raje. And it's, I'll quote from here, tourism could be India's largest employer. And it says very, very revealing two things, and I thought I must bring it to you. India gets fewer tourists than a single museum, the Louvre in Paris. I can't believe it, but that's written here. And Rajasthan gets less tourists than one single monument, Angkor Wat. But these are facts, whether we like it or we don't. The second, after foreign exchange earnings, is the generation of employment. Everybody knows that opportunities for job creation provided by tourism in general. It's promotion of local handicrafts, which is far more important when you talk about the impact of tourism. And therefore, diverted, the local culture is diverted from unethical means of survival into something productive. And that is responsibility is that of tourism. The careful things that we need all have to understand is the damage to environment. People keep on pointing out tourism, you're damaging environment. Yes or no? Overusage. Number of visitors exceed the carrying capacity of the location. Obviously, you're damaging the environment. Or underusage, it results in decay of the village industry. So we've got to find a balance between the two. But what is forgotten about the benefits of tourism is this one, regional integration. That's very, very important, which not many people focus on, regional integration. And here I'm coming to people from Japan coming to India. I was the chairman of the SAARC Chamber Tourism Council, and we are working very hard to try and implement and get what is known as the SAARC visa. Visa which entitles a person to go to any of the SAARC countries on the same lines as the Schengen visa is. Now, it may not be for you and for me, all right, but for a Japanese to come to India, he doesn't come only for India, he goes also to Nepal. And he has to have an entry visa for India, entry visa for Japan, and from Kathmandu, he has to come back to Delhi to take the flight back home. So he needs multiple entry visa to India. Now, if his travel agent has mixed it up and given only single entry, he's in trouble. So, you know, these are some of the things that we should do to develop close relationship between our two countries. What are the suggested strategies? A, you market a location as standalone approach, that is only India or only Mumbai or only Maharashtra. No, that's too expensive. Stopover connectivity, which I just mentioned, stopover from people coming to India, go to Nepal, or maybe they spend 4 or 5 days in India and go to the Far East or what, Middle East or wherever else, or a joint promotion. I think joint promotion is the best thing that we in the countries in the neighborhood could promote together when we do it with Japan. Why not? I mean, that would be bring more the whole picture together. And that's the best way, cheapest and the easiest way to promote. But the potential travelers of today are, surprisingly, I don't see anybody over here that fits into this description. It is the people like me, gray hair. It's older generation. That's the new breed of people who want to take holidays. Why? Because they've got three basic ingredients, which is very, very necessary for a holiday. One is health. With the advancement of medication, you have much better health than what it was earlier. Wealth, you earn enough in your lifetime. And the time, you're retired, so you have the time. So you've got all the three, and these are the people that we should attack to bring them to India and Indians to go there. The ratio of business travel to leisure travel, as I mentioned, tourists, no. Visitors, yes. It's 70 to 30. Surprising. 70% of the people who travel worldwide, and people from Japan coming to India, 70% of those are not necessarily tourists. I mean, they may do sightseeing, but they've come here for business. What we call business meetings, incentives, conferences, exhibitions, what we in our language call MICE. Meetings, incentives, conference, exhibitions. And incentives in between, which I mentioned, has a fantastic tax advantages because it's tax deductible expense for the giver. That is the company which makes a group. They give it, it's a tax deductible expense for them, and to the recipient is a non-taxable perquisite. So I think this is something that we need to promote within us. The current trends now have changed. A, the duration of stay, and how do we get people coming from far distance, for example, South America, Colombia, to India, maybe trickle. Japan is in the middle haul. So long haul, at this moment, just leave it on one side because people don't have the time to travel 24 hours to come for a holiday. So middle haul, maybe short haul. Short haul would be within the SAARC countries because 30% of the tourists coming to India are short haul. But what we are looking for is middle haul, which includes Japan, India, Indians going there. And short duration, now it's Sunday to Sunday, 1 week. Gone are the days where people used to travel for longer, 2 weeks going on a cruise and so on and so forth. Maybe some of you still have that time, energy, and to do that and the money. And therefore, our best people, our best marketing is done by repeat visitors. I call them the ambassadors. A happy person returning is your best ambassador. Now, need of the future is what we need is institutes like IHM in Aurangabad, for example, multilingual guides. You would be surprised, and I have those figures that I don't have the Japanese-speaking guides, but Chinese-speaking guides at the Government of India Tourist Office in Mumbai. I'm not going to ask you that question because you'll all be wrong if I ask you and you return that money. There's only one Chinese-speaking guide connected with the Government of India Tourist Office. I hope by the time I finish my talk, there'll be two, at least. So conflicts, terrorism, unrest, these are the enemies of tourism. Today, the tourism industry is wondering what is going to happen, where, when, how. Regrettably, it is not asking the question, why? Why should it happen? Conflict and unrest are the worst enemies of so-called industry of peace. And here I remember Bill Clinton, the former president, had said that past is history. You cannot change the past, but the future is in our hands. We can mold the future to the best of our ability, and that is what we should be looking for today. And where I need the help of all of you, it's not me alone who will be talking tourism. I have one. By the time I finish in the next 2 minutes, I think I still have two more minutes. All of you will be saying one word, tourism, back and forth. And that reminds me of an Airtel TV commercial. It's a 10-second commercial. I hope I'm not violating any rules. But if you recollect, about a year, 2 years back, this said something like this: Jo mera hai, wo tera hai. Jo mera hai, wo tera hai. Jo tera hai, wo mera hai. So which means all of us need to work together. Now, the value perception of visitors to India, what are those? These are, think of India and what instantly comes to your mind. I'll give you four or five. You can add many more. And it is a truth that visitors were interviewed, and this is what they said. The rhythm of Hindi film music produced romance in the air. That's what one of the foreigners said. People are very hospitable. Bullock cart and BMW were standing side by side at the traffic lights. Tandoori chicken was delicious. Wow, so why not? Let's do something about that. Sachin Tendulkar was worshipped like a god. Now, these are the facts. I was treated like a Maharaja. Overall, I got my money's worth. Now, I hope I'm not breaking any rules. I want to quote something from a book it'll take no more than 30 seconds. Before I go there, I hope I'm not breaking any rules. There are no protocols. Just one more minute.
This. Staring at me, I'm staring at you.
It's something to do with sex. Our approach to tourism promotion should be like sex. What do I mean? Sex is people don't talk. They just do it. In tourism, people own and they do nothing. So let's do what the other one. Now give me just 30 seconds. This is a lovely book which I got, and I thought, let me say that nowadays, when you describe a country, you talk about one thing, not necessarily Switzerland as such. You talk of fondue, and you'll think of Switzerland. You talk about waffles, you think about Belgium. You think about sushi and sake, right? We are already thirsty. Your Excellency, the Consul General is here. Sake, and you think of Japan. Puri bhaji, bhel puri. You can try and tell idli dosas, hot samosas, you will like it well. Once you come to stay, then you won't like to go away. Come to Bombay, Bombay meri hai. And let's all say the same thing, and I want all of you to work together. And finally, it says, even this, the author says, I believe falling in love with a city or a country is just as exciting as falling in love with a person. So let we fall in love with Japan, Japanese fall in love with us, and all of you have to work together. All of you, I need your help to ensure that when we meet again, I'll have some better figures. I'm not giving you the figures. They are with me, but I'm not giving you the figures of the number of tourists between our two countries. But let me, just the last one, 5 seconds. It's not that exciting. Indians going to Japan, the 2014 published figures are 87,967. Now that's just a drop. And Japanese coming to India in 2014, recorded figures are 220,000. So, I mean, this is just literally peanuts, and we need to very quickly, by the time we meet next, ensure that this is not only double but more than that. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure talking to you. Sir.
माफ़ कीजिए हम इंग्लिश नहीं आते हैं और हमारा हिंदी भी इतना बराबर नहीं है तो आप लोग सुनने में ज़रा दिक्कत होएगा तो क्षमा कीजिए जापानीज बहुत सॉरी सॉरी बोलते हैं आप लोग जानते हैं कि वरुणी में चप्पम बुद्धा मंदिर है मैं उधर का पुजारी है चार साल पहले हम मंदिर में होली में आए थे मंदिर का पुजारी बन गया था पहले बाहर जाके मंदिर से बाहर जाके कुछ ना कुछ एक्टिविटी करते थे अभी हमारा उम्र आ गया है थोड़ा बाहर का एक्टिविटी नहीं हो सकते हैं इसके लिए हम पिछले 7-8 साल पहले से हम मंदिर में रहते हैं मंदिर में बेसकर ही बाबा साहब अम्बेडकर को मानने वाला नवोदित लोगों को मंदिर में आते हैं लेकिन सौभाग्य बात यह है कि हर एक देश प्रदेश हर एक संप्रदाय हर एक जात हर एक कम्युनिटी का लोग हमारा मंदिर में आके दर्शन के लिए आते हैं अब उधर हम बताते हैं कि जो जापानी व्यापारी जो ट्रांजिट के लिए आते हैं तो इधर का पार्टनर है एक दिन दो दिन छुट्टी का समय में साइसिंग के लिए हमारा मंदिर में लेके आता है काफी आता है और टूरिस्ट गाइड जो व्यक्तिगत में विदेशी आते हैं वो हमारा मंदिर में लेके आते हैं और एक बार जापान से व्यापारी का डेलीगेशन आए थे और 2 साल पहले जो जापानीज कम्युनिटी का यंग जनरेशन स्टडी के लिए हमारा मंदिर में आया हमारा स्पीच सुनने के लिए और बॉम्बे एक्सप्लोरर करके ये विदेशियों का औरत लोगों को जो अमेरिकन स्कूल का जो पेरेंट है वो लोगों ने एक संगठन है बॉम्बे एक्सप्लोइटेशन बॉम्बे हमारा मंदिर में क्या है करके वो लोग डेलीगेशन आए थे तो मैं वो लोग को एक्सप्लेन करते हैं ये मंदिर हमारा मंदिर हिंदू ने बनाया शेठ जगर किशोर बिरला और हमारा गुरु जी को दिया ये हमारा गुरु जी हुजी गुरु जी भारत का इंडिया का संग्राम में इंडिपेंडेंस मूवमेंट में हिस्सा लिया था तो सपनी साधु के लिए हम मंदिर बनाएगा मंदिर बने और मैं जितना व्यापारी आते हैं मैं इसको इस एक्सप्रेशन करते हैं कि अजंता एलोरा नासिक में लेनी है वो सब व्यापारी ने बनाया व्यापारी खाली बिजनेस का नहीं है व्यापारी का मतलब है खर्चा एक्सचेंज करने वाला है खर्चर एक्सचेंज करके जहां जहां जो सांप्रदायिक थाना होता है कम्युनल होता है दंगा फसाद होता है उधर हिंसा से अहिंसा परिवर्तन करने के लिए जो पुराना जमाने का व्यापारी ने कल्चर हेरिटेज बना के देश विदेश को शांति दे रहे भारत ये कौमी एकता एकांतता सेक्युलर का प्रतीक है हमारे मंदिर में बहुत सौभाग्य बात यह है कि अभी अभी आया था एचआर कॉलेज का सोशियोलॉजी का छात्र लोगों को एसएनडीटी का हिस्टोरिकल डिपार्टमेंट का छात्र लोगों को जय हिंद कॉलेज का मास मीडिया का छात्रों का है और विद्या मंदिर का जो स्कूल का बच्चों को हमारे मंदिर में बहुत आते रहते हैं और जापानीज स्कूल का जो ये जापानीज जो सीखते हैं वो लोग भी हमारा मंदिर में आते हैं। तो मैं यंग जनरेशन को मैं इतना एक्सप्लेन करना चाहते हैं कि हमारा अनुभव और आजकल मैं पहले बहुत ये एक्टिविटी कर देते बाहर ये शांति को मिलाने के लिए कौमी एकता कांतता के लिए तो पेपर पेपर में आता था। आजकल यूट्यूब आ रहा है ये ऐसा कोई नेट आ रहा है एक साइट आ रहा है ऐसा कि हमारा शूटिंग करते हैं या इंटरव्यू करते हैं। मैं उन लोग को अपना एक्सपीरियंस अनुभव बताते हैं। 1987 गणतंत्र दिवस का एक दिन पहले स्वतंत्र सेनानी डॉक्टर उषा बेन ने हमको फोन में बताया तुम घर से पंजाब तक पदयात्रा करो। हम गया उषा बेन का जो आदेश है मैं सुन लिया तो स्वर्गीय श्री श्रीदत्त ने गणतंत्र दिवस से पंजाब तक पदयात्रा किया था मैं के साथ में गया। आप लोग सब जानते हैं उस समय में हरियाणा पंजाब एक ये गर्व का ये एक लड़ाई होता आग जलता था। तो खास करके हरियाणा पंजाब में आम जनता ने पूरे मोहब्बत भाईचारा का दुनिया देखा। मैंने राष्ट्रपति के द्वारा भारत का जो अहिंसा नॉन वायलेंस का दुनिया देखा है। 1992 6 दिसंबर में बाबरी मस्जिद का ढांचा गिरा तो मैं हमेशा करते थे बाहर जाके ये प्रोग्राम करने का ये पीस मार्च करने का पहले से करते थे। तो उस समय में कोई रास्ता पे कोई नहीं थे पुलिस मिलिट्री प्रेस का गाड़ी था। मैं वहाँ अकेला बाजा बाजा के नाम में होने के उद्घोष करके ब्राह्मण किया। तो बाइकरा में खुरिशा का जो खरोनी है वो खुरिशा लोगों को ने टेरेस के ऊपर में हमको ये तारीफ किया और बोला गॉड ब्लेस यू। और 2005 से 2006 तक अहमदाबाद से गांधी जी का स्वर्ग सत्याग्रह है यात्रा है मैं 75 ईयर्स का जो स्मारक थे तो हम देश विदेश से बुला के अहमदाबाद से शुरू किए। आखिर में सूरत नवासारी का बॉर्डर में एक ये मदरसा है उधर का मूला लोगों को ने रास्ता पे आए और ये एक एक गुलाब का फूल फादरों को हाथ में सौंप दिया और मदरसा का अंदर लेके गए। हमने उस समय में स्पीच दिया तुम लोग ने भारत का कौमी एकता अखंडता था भाईचारा का ये जोश दिखाया। मैं बहुत हमारा किस्मत बहुत अच्छा है लगभग भारत में हम 1970 में आए थे लेकिन अभी तक भारत का सब जनता ने हमारा पूरे मोहब्बत है। और इतना संस्कार मिला इतना सभ्यता मिला हमारा बहुत गौरव की बात समझते हैं अपना जिंदगी को। और भारत जापान हमारा अनुभव है मुकाबला करते हैं मुकाबला कर सकते हैं। हमारे जो देश में नहीं है ये देश में है हमारे देश में नहीं है भारत में है। भारत जो धर्म का भावना स्पिरिचुअल का भावना ये सारी दुनिया में सबसे ये श्रेष्ठ है। हमारा देश में है धार्मिक भावना है लेकिन लड़ाई के बाद में अमेरिकन का प्रभाव से थोड़ा हमारा जापान का जो रीति रिवाज रिचुअल थोड़ा गैप हो रहा है। लेकिन हमारा देश लोगों को डिसिप्लिन आप लोग सब जानते हैं डिसिप्लिन शिष्टाचार स्वच्छ और इक्विटी में पूरा भरवा है कि भारत जापान हर एक विषय में एक साथ रहेगा तो दोनों देश के लिए बहुत फायदा होगा। और हमारा पूरा अनुभव है काफी जापान से काफी डेलीगेशन आए थे हिरोशिमा नागासाकी का पीस डेलीगेशन भी आए थे हर एक डेलीगेशन आए थे तो मैं इधर का गांधीवादी है ये ह्यूमन राइट वाला है उनके साथ कोऑर्डिनेट करके जापानीज डेलीगेशन को हम लोगों ने ऑर्गेनाइज किया। उस समय में भी एसपी गोदरेज लालजी मेहरोत्रा और बाबूराव मकारी का बेटी उषा पारिक पूरा हमारा ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के लिए कोऑर्डिनेट के लिए पूरा सपोर्ट किया। जो व्यापारी ने केवल व्यापारी नहीं करते हैं सामाजिक के लिए सामाजिक का जुड़ने के लिए जो योगदान करेगा योगदान करते हैं ये मैं समझता कि भारत का परंपरा है। हम ज्यादा बोलना चाहते हैं लेकिन समय का कमी है इसके लिए मैं समाप्त करता हूँ। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। भारत ने हमको बहुत अच्छा दिया सब कुछ दिया हमको बहुत आप लोग के मैं शुक्रिया गुजार का करने का आप लोगों का नम्रता पूर्वक धन्यवाद नमस्कार ये बताने के लिए आप लोग का प्रति आया बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
Bhikshu finds in India what he doesn't find in his own country, and Abha finds in Hiroshima what she doesn't find in India. What a glorious mix. Parshuram, you.
अमूष गंध शाऊका ची गमापनी सनिपमगमपमगस निज गम पम ग स नि स ग ज नि प नि म प नि नि स
यू नो आस्किंग अ वन्नबी स्टूडेंट ऑफ म्यूजिक एंड अ वन्नबी स्टोरी टेलर इट्स नथिंग शॉर्ट ऑफ हाराकिरी to ask him to come and speak because if you call some person like that he's either going to sing or dance or tell you stories and Sujinder ji I'm going to do both I'm now going to tell you a little story is the screen on there okay
come on me Akiru was a Japanese boy who drew cats. Now, there's nothing wrong with drawing cats. Lots of people draw cats. But Akiru was different. He drew only cats. Nothing but cats. No dogs, no horses, no houses, mountains, flowers, or people. Only cats. And he drew them all the time. His brothers and sisters helped their parents in the fields. But Akiru sat at the edge of the field, drawing cats in the wet mud.
Why do you draw cats all the time?
His mother asked him one day.
You see, mother,
Akiru told her solemnly,
I have to keep practicing until I draw the perfect cat. And what is the perfect cat?
Akiru replied, frowning with thought.
But it's not this.
And he wiped out the cat he had drawn in the mud.
Looks like a perfectly good cat to me.
His mother sighed, shaking her head and wondering what would become of her odd little boy. Finally, Akiru's parents decided to send him to a nearby temple to study under the priest there. He's not made for the fields and farming, said his father.
Maybe he'll become a learned priest,
said his mother. At the temple, the students learned to make ink, dip the brush in the ink, and write with the brush. But Akiru dipped his brush in the ink and drew cats. When he was asked to write a word, he drew a cat. When he was asked to add two and two, he drew a cat. Then one day, when everyone was taking an afternoon nap, he drew cats on all the rice paper screens in the temple.
As I walked into this room this afternoon,
early afternoon or late morning, trying to figure out what is it that I'm really going to talk about, because we are living in times where I believe language has almost become a complete impediment to understanding. That's not my word, it's Bill Watterson's. I see the flag. Dhaval, how do I get the flag back? You know, the what struck me most that is that this is the way, by the way, this the reason I played this story and what I attempted to sing is something called Akaru. Akaru is a very traditional folk, and as I'm sure all of you are aware, folk traditions are what gave rise to the classical music traditions, not only in this part of the world, but across cultures. Is that, you know, one does not really know where it came from. Did Shuddha Dhanyasi in Carnatic music come from the Akaru, or vice versa? One really doesn't know, and one can only, you know, think of probably a time when John Lennon, you know, said that, you know, there are countries without boundaries. Probably that was the reason why there has been such almost unimaginable osmosis of not only what today we call culture, but of ideas overall. But what struck me in the flag, I do not know if it's true, is that my teachers have always told me, my teachers in music, that if at all there is, first of all, teachers don't speak. But one of the things that I've heard them saying is that the idea of a Nada Bindu is, as you all know, is zero dimension. Nada is when silence through aghat becomes sound, that is nada. So sound bindu is basically where you try to become zero dimensional, that means without your own identity, through nada. So for me, if somebody were to ask me, I have not read any books, I'm not a historian, and I'm not apologizing for that. But for me, if somebody were to ask me, what is Japan and what is India and what are you? Is there a tripartite agreement? For me, that tripartite agreement is Shuddha Dhanyasi and this Nada Bindu. Thank you so much.
So I think with this eloquent summing up, I think we should, in the silence, the note of silence that he has evoked at the end, ask what has really been spoken from the, what did we all speak? But I think the core of it all is that the essence of Buddhism was to bring compassion into the center stage, something which is perhaps almost evaporating. As I was telling my friends before I came, you go to any part of India, you can get great entertainment, but you don't get water, you don't get infrastructure. So in times like this, I think a land which prides itself about giving birth to Buddha needs to do a lot, along with Japan, to keep the spirit of the Buddha alive through, as Abba so eloquently said, the living tradition perhaps is disappearing. And this tendency, as Jayaji said in the very beginning, is that the tendency to put the name above the title, and art, especially in the world of cinema, we are getting more and more obsessed with the name above the title. And gone are those days where there was this community feeling where people worked together to create something which was enduring, which actually, you know, strive to touch somebody out there, not to win applause and get accolades. So with that, we come to an end of the session, and we perhaps have a little time for questions and answers, or we...